Most grads, interns will arrive at a meeting and they will try to make themselves very small.
Yeah.
They'll put all their books and things in, although if they even bring a book, they usually just bring their phone and a laptop. So first of all, actually, I help them with the culture in the company. So I've worked for, at Apple, for example, you didn't write, you didn't bring notebooks to Apple meetings, you all brought your Mac.
Yeah.
And we type notes. And that was the culture.
Yeah.
At L'Oreal, anyone who was on a computer in a meeting, well, you must not be paying attention. You must be on Facebook or Insta.
That's right. Yeah.
That's the culture. So as a manager, help navigate them through the cultural differences. At L'Oreal, take a book. At Apple, take a laptop. But get them to start looking out for what, how do things run in this company.
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Born to Speak podcast, where I'll be interviewing experts from around the world from different areas of communication to help make sure that you get those tips and techniques that can really help you excel in your personal and your professional life to get the results you really deserve when you've got an important idea or pitch or speech or conversation coming up to make sure you get the results that you want from those situations. Today, I'm really thrilled to be joined by Di Macdonald. Di and I have actually known each other and worked together on many projects over the years. And just to give you a bit of a quick intro to who Di is, she, as an example from her career, she worked for 3 years at Apple as the head of sales and retail training across 18 countries, specifically working on the iPhone and the iPad. So if during the last few years you've been into an Apple store and been amazed by the quality of the customer service that you get there, or even if you went into another store and you had someone explain the iPhone to you, part of the impact that you're getting there has come from work that Di was doing with Apple. Also, she worked as director of frontline training for EE, which if you're from outside of the UK, because I'm so fascinated by the fact we now have people from 93 countries listening to, tuning into the podcast. So if you're not aware, EE and BT have joined together in the UK to make the largest mobile telecoms network in the UK. And at Expedia, Di was VP of Global Learning. At L'Oreal, she was the Director of Learning. So she's got an amazing wealth of experience of what good quality learning and communication looks like to produce fantastic results at these very well-known international companies. The value that I think you'll really get out of this podcast is that we're going to be looking at how do people communicate effectively in business, but specifically through the lens of Di being the founder of the company Like Literally, which I think is a brilliant name for a company, which is all about bridging the gap between people who are just leaving education and then getting into the workplace. And so if you're new to the workplace, if you've newly graduated, if you're just starting out in your career, figuring out what do you need to know in order to make sure you're communicating well and doing your best as you get into the workplace. But also for those of you who I know who listen to this, who are managers and you're concerned about how do you interact with this younger generation? How do you make sure you support them, that you get the best engagement and productivity out of them, the best relationships with them? How does that work? So we'll be diving into all of those areas. So, Di.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Just
for
made
being
me sound
here.
Really old. She's worked here.
She's
she
been
worked
doing
here.
This for hundreds of years. That's right. So, from your wealth of decades of experience,
thank you.
What was your reason for founding Like Literally? What was the gap that you were noticing that you're aiming to serve?
Well, interestingly, first of all, I noticed this gap when I was at L'Oreal, but how I came about founding my company, and I'll go back to what I observed at L'Oreal, was whilst I was doing my TED Talk training with one of your trainers, Steve Cerosi,
really?
Where I had to come up with an idea, and I thought, oh gosh, I could just re-churn my usual ideas for a TED Talk, but then I really stepped back and thought, I've had this intern for the last 12 months, and honestly, and she knows this, so I can say this without offending her now, at the 2-month mark, I went back to HR and just went, it's not really working out. Can I give her back? And they said, no. And then I really thought, you know, it was like having, I mean, she was a teenager, and it was like having a Labrador puppy in the office. Really welcoming and great fun, but sometimes, you know, she'll be chewing your shoes and other times you don't know where she is. And and so I then thought, if I had a Labrador puppy for a year, at the end of a year, it could either be chewing your shoes or it could be a seeing-eyed dog puppy. Mm. And the only difference is the leader of that. And so what I took it upon myself to do was turn her into a rock star that year and gave her, I mean, at the end of the year, she could communicate to anybody at any level. She was able to build rapport with the CEO and the coffee guy, everything in between. She could write a snappy email. She could just get things done. She could prioritize and was proactive, unlike any of the other interns that I could see.
Right.
And I could see a lot of them really just treading water, going, not really sure what I'm supposed to be doing, and managers going, it's a Labrador puppy, it's not my problem.
Yeah.
So that's where I decided somebody's got to bridge this gap. And whose job is it? Because the corporates, a lot of the corporates think, wow, they're only here for a year.
Mm.
We're not going to invest too much. And I've been to the universities and I've met the academics. They're just not, they've not worked in corporate. They don't know what expectations are. So what I do now is I come in to the corporates and I get these guys at their first week and give them really, I wrap this up in a nutshell of how not to look like the grad, the intern or the apprentice in the room.
Yeah.
All the skills that I'm giving them are really helping that.
Yeah.
And what I also do is then train the managers, because I was so ill prepared for managing this age group. I've been managing 35-year-old directors for the last 10, 15 years.
Yeah.
Suddenly I've got a teenager. I mean, I haven't had kids because I don't want a teenager. So I do that balancing act of both of them, because I really struggled going, you know, just writing objectives for someone who's never worked in the corporate world.
Yeah.
They're completely different to writing an objective for you, for example.
Yeah, and actually, because the level that we tend to go in at is working at the manager level. Yeah. I've heard a lot of people say, why don't these new people coming in act like us? Why don't they understand what's wrong? Rather than them maybe thinking, well, hang on a second, I'm from a different generation to them, and therefore, what do I need to be doing that could be better supportive of them? The other side that I've also noticed a lot is that people who are heads of learning and development will say to us, we're going to get you to work with people who are very senior. We don't tend to invest that much in people who are new. It's kind of a sink or swim environment before we start to invest. So it's kind of great to hear that you're working with them in that first week, because otherwise you could have someone who's really a gem, who could turn out to be a diamond, but you don't know unless you invest.
Exactly. And a lot of the work I do with them is, I mean, it is generational, because I was a couple of generations away. Couple's probably being generous. I think I'm the same age as her mum. But and sometimes you feel like the parent.
Yeah.
But very much it's like you say. I mean, I was guilty of that. I brought you guys in to take our execs and make them look like rock stars.
Yeah.
But the flip side is, yes, of course you've got to give it to these young kids so they don't have to be fixed when they're 50.
Yeah.
They can be rock stars when they're 21.
Is this something that is happening more at the moment, where is there something like a greater expectation that we have of people coming out of education, that they should be able to communicate with people of every level because there's less hierarchical systems at play? Or is this something that's kind of always existed but never been addressed?
I think there's a couple of things. I think firstly, the kids coming out have this ambition that I know I didn't have, because my role models that I want to be when I grow up were either supermodels or athletes, really.
Yeah.
And I knew I wasn't that good looking, and I knew I was not that great at sport. Well, I was very good at sport, but not quite that good.
Right.
So, but they were our role models.
Yeah.
Whereas these days, the role models these kids have got is Kylie Jenner, who's a billionaire at the age of 20 for making some lipstick.
Yeah.
And people who are Instagrammers and influencers who can make 10 grand a day by just going to Coachella and going, hey, I love this lipstick or this nail polish. And so it's very attainable. And so they're very hungry. And I think that's reverse engineered behaviors that we certainly didn't have when I came in. I sat in, I shut up and I behaved. Because I didn't know that I could do that. Like, that was not an ambition for me apart from spend a couple of years in that job and then maybe I could move up a little bit and then I'll move up a little bit and then I'll maybe go to another country.
Yeah.
So I think it's driven by them, not by the managers. If you're a manager sitting there going, why can't I control them? It's not you, it's them, and it's not a bad thing.
Yeah.
But you've got to know what to do with them.
It's great to have people coming in with that ambition.
It is.
Definitely. And I've seen that, I've heard people talk about it where they went with tremendous ambition to maybe their manager, And their manager said to them, look, here's what you have to do. Put your head down for the next 10 years and you may not like it, but then you'll get the experience you need to be asking the questions you're asking now. Right, and then they're going to be thinking, forget it, I'm gone, which is a tremendous loss of money for, you know, trying to bring in people to the business. So then let's start to get practical on that. So let's say that you're speaking to a manager who might be listening to this thinking, I completely relate to what's being said here. What can they start to do? Some sort of easy wins with the interns, the younger people in their business, to start to make sure they're getting them to a place of more productivity or the right kind of support, adapting in whatever way they need to.
I think first of all is their mindset of you can't change these kids' ambitions. So telling them they need to behave like you are behaving as a 35-year-old, 40-year-old, whatever, it is exactly the worst thing to do. And telling them, in my day, never start a sentence with that, ever.
In my day, just makes you sound old.
You sound like your dad, someone's dad. Yeah. So, but very much the mindset of how do I harness this ambition and really look at how can I make these kids rock stars, because I hope one day I'm working for my intern. And that's the mentality I've taken. Look, I just want to accelerate you past me. I don't want to hold you back. And you lucky kids being in this generation where that is actually possible.
Yeah.
You know, you look at all of the Zuckerbergs, the Steve Jobses, the Gates, all of these kids started their company before they were 22 or something. It's insane.
Yeah.
And yet, so that was happening in our day. It was just the freaks. Now they're everywhere. Yeah. So I think it's a matter of what skills can I give to this generation and this person that I have in my care to turn them into a rock star. I would start with things like just understanding the fact that it's not always about generation, it's about style. Like some people are extroverts and some people are introverts. How they communicate within a generation is clunky. Some people are very task orientated, some people are very people orientated, so there's clunkiness there within a generation. So one of the things, I'm a big fan of DISC. I think it's a great model of just getting people to understand, look, let's forget generations, let's have a look at how we work and what's driving me intrinsically that I can't help. So as a D and a secondary I, I'm always extroverted, I need things done quickly, I'll be very direct. So if I know that I've got an intern who's the exact opposite style to me, I will then, which I did and I have had, you then look at how I'm going to get the best out of this person. Actually, I'm going to have to adapt my style to do that, to nurture them.
And it's nice to think that actually it's not a bad thing. Like, don't hire someone who has the same style, because they'll see the world differently.
Totally.
And therefore, both of you working together is going to give you that sort of optimum vision of things around you. So I really like that. And then what about, I'm wondering, if you've got people coming in who have tremendous ambition, who feel like I'm unique and special and I can do tremendous things, how does a manager give them feedback in a way that doesn't, you know, almost burst the balloon for them? How do they do that carefully?
Feedback, I find, is also very much different these days. These kids want feedback instantly. They're getting likes on their Facebook. They're not on Facebook. Of course they're not on
Instagram,
Facebook.
Instagram, Snapchat.
Insta, Snap, whatever. They're getting likes. They're getting instant feedback on behavior. And that's translated into the business world now, where they're like, well, I was training some finance grads a couple of weeks ago, and one of the questions they asked was, I've asked my manager for feedback and they said you're doing everything fine. Well, I know I'm not. I want to be able to do things better.
Yeah.
What's he holding back? And I said, he might not be holding anything back. He might just think you're doing a great job. Well, how do I get more out of it? So some of the things we're looking at, asking questions if you are a grad, saying, if I was to do that task again, how could I do it better? So for a manager, I think framing it like that to say, look, you've done this brilliantly. Let's rewind to the beginning and look, if you were to do all this again, how could you do it better? What do you think you could do better? So throwing it back to them to do some self-analysis rather than being the top down.
Right. I love that. That sense of taking ownership over it.
Simply reversing that question to them.
Which is actually, that ties into the way, if I think about social media, where I've learned very quickly, I went in with a strategy on Instagram thinking, I've seen
people... Well, that's your first mistake.
Damn, what was I doing? But I had this idea that I was seeing other people share inspiring quotes, and I thought, well, I've got some inspiring quotes from my book, I'm going to share those. And so I was putting those out, and then occasionally I had a picture of me training a room of people. And me training a room of people is getting five times the number of likes,
people want to see that,
and engagement. And so I very quickly learned, okay, that's what's working, that's what's not. Yep. And I took ownership of that and thought, okay, let's switch it around. Occasional comment, but more likely a picture of me doing something interesting is what people want. So it sort of sounds like that's actually what this younger generation is thinking, is after a meeting, well, I need to know how many likes and comments am I getting on this?
It's exactly that. You know? If I went, and I really, when I was working with Fionn, my intern, was setting her up at the beginning to say, look, I'm going to give you a whole heap of feedback. Yeah. In the next year, I'm going to give you loads of feedback because I want you to be a rock star and I want to help you not look like the intern in the room. Yeah. Is that cool?
Yeah.
And she went, yeah. I said, so the purpose and the spirit behind all of my feedback, because some might hurt, is helping you look like a rock star. So here's an example. She used to twirl her hair all the time like that to be in meetings. So all I said was, if I did this in a meeting, what would you think? And she goes, oh yeah, I know, I do it all the time.
Yeah.
And I said, I don't really care if you do it, but how do you think you look in a meeting doing that? And she's like, I said, you look like the intern in the room. So everything came back to, I'm helping you not look like the intern in the room. And they don't want to look like the intern in the room because they want to be taken seriously because they have got all this ambition.
Yeah.
They want visibility of senior leadership. Give it to them, but don't give it to them without preparing them for how you're going to look. I do a lot of work with body language and, you know, in a meeting, most grads interns will arrive at a meeting and they'll try to make themselves very small.
Yeah.
They'll put all their books and things in, although if they even bring a book, they usually just bring their phone and a laptop. Yeah. So first of all, actually, I help them with the culture in the company. So I've worked at Apple, for example. You didn't bring notebooks to Apple meetings, you all brought your Mac and we type notes, and that was the culture at L'Oreal. Anyone who was on a computer in a meeting, well, you must not be paying attention, you must be on Facebook or Insta.
That's right.
That's the culture. So as a manager, help navigate them through the cultural differences. At L'Oreal, take a book. At Apple, take a laptop. But get them to start looking out for how do things run in this company. But here's how they'll sit. They'll sit very small. They'll put their hands under there and they'll, because they don't want to be seen usually in their very, very early days.
Yeah.
So help them. Say, look, how does this look if I did this? And how do you feel with me sitting like that as opposed to me matching your body language, which is what I train them in to say, matching body language will start to build rapport.
Yeah.
So get your hands on that. It's a bit like your BBC presenter hands.
Right, exactly,
You've got somewhere to, you can make points and you've got somewhere to come back to when you're sitting at a table.
Yeah, exactly. It's so nice for them to get that sort of insight, which I know for me, age 16, when someone handed me a book on body language, was like, oh,
blows your mind.
What? I didn't know this stuff existed.
Yeah.
It's that lovely way of looking at it. So maybe for a manager, I can imagine that it's about total compassion with that person rather than thinking this person's no good in a meeting, seeing actually they are there to be sort of brought out of themselves from this raw potential that they are to be sculpted into something that could be incredible. If only
think
that
of them like a puppy. Think of them like a Labrador puppy who you got to turn into a seeing eye dog, because if you were given a puppy, you would do everything you could to make and that includes discipline, it includes boundaries, it includes really thinking about how you're going to manage these puppies.
Yeah.
Because one of the other side is I've seen managers do is they just go to town and everything's positive feedback, positive. Oh, you're amazing. Well, you weren't really. So having some discipline, when they're painting their nails at their desk at 5 o'clock.
Right.
Have a chat. And mostly it's just saying, how do you think you're being perceived whilst you're doing that in the office?
So to give maybe like a sense around what that communication looks like, I spoke on the previous podcast, we were talking about how Hillary Clinton kind of failed when she said, she was talking about Pokemon Go and will young people Pokemon Go to the polls? And it just sounded like,
don't
try and speak someone's language if you don't really get it. So you've really got to be, yourself in that. So it sounds like you're saying, don't go in with like a parent-child mentality. Yeah. How would you put it? How would you put those roles?
I mean, it has to be an adult. I know I use the analogy of a puppy, but I do that in the sense of you'll do everything to turn it into a great, great dog.
Yeah.
But it has to be adult-adult relationship. Yeah. And I do, when I train managers, I do, and especially when we talk about storytelling. In fact, that's one of the big things is, storytelling can become very parent-child, very quickly, because it can become very patronizing. So it's about understanding that these are adults now, and you treat them as adults, and you want equal adult-adult, because that's how you're going to get respect. You're not going to get respect if you're going in parent-child.
Yeah. We talk about this in terms of storytelling that you mentioned there about, you know, maybe thinking of yourself as sort of mentor and hero, where you can say, look, I know this person is going to be amazing. I'm going to be a mentor that helps them get there, or even an ally on their journey, one of those things, rather than that top-down dictatorial sort of position. So you mentioned there that the hair twirling.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to get into this world of helping. This is kind of another side of communication, which I don't normally touch on for people, but I think it's important now. More people are asking me about this, the new world of business casual that's going on, where suddenly we realize nobody's really wearing a tie anymore. And so if I go to a conference or a company where people are wearing ties, I see
quite alarming.
What's something very serious
going on here?
Something illegal is going to happen today.
Boris is coming here.
So how do you help both sort of manager and these new interns navigate that business casual approach, both from sort of what they're wearing and also through conversations and email and all those things?
The dress code is a nightmare.
Yeah.
It really is a nightmare. And I think the fact that there's business casual are two words, it's like yes, no.
Yeah.
They do not belong together.
Yeah.
It is the dress code designed by the devil.
Right.
So the advice I give to interns and grads going into corporate is look up. Look a couple of rungs up and look for people who are credible, who are doing a good job, who people are talking about in a positive way.
Mm.
And don't dress like them, because you're 20 and they're probably 40.
Mm.
But just have a think about, well, how could I that translate to Topshop? You know, when I'm shopping, what sort of things am I going to be starting to look for? Because I really have had, and I've worked in HR for a long time, and the number of conversations about dress code for young people because they are coming in. But first, here's my first rule, and this is my personal one.
Yeah.
No UGG boots and no bare midriff.
Right.
You've got better abs than me because you're 20. Well done. I don't want to see them.
Keep them away.
But that's my advice, is just look a couple of rungs up in your organisation. And also, when I'm training grads before they've entered, so I'll teach at a business school on how to present yourself in an interview.
Yeah.
I'll get them to go to where they're going to have their interview a couple of days beforehand, sit outside and just watch the people coming and going in the office. What are they wearing?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because so often I see grads coming for the grad program interview, and it looks like an episode of The Apprentice in the reception.
Right.
Everyone's been shopping at Next, or there's a lot of black suits going on, and it looks like they've been dressed by their mum.
Right.
And that's not what we as managers, I want to see, who are you when you come to interview without UGG boots and a bare midriff? But I want to see who you are. So bring some personality to that, bring some personality to what you're wearing.
Yeah.
But be respectful and just have a look, because what looks hot on the beach and in Ibiza and even in Topshop on a Saturday it might look hot, but it doesn't look hot when you're midday in a meeting with senior leadership team at Apple.
So let's bring that idea then into sort of digital communication, where I've noticed people start to get into trouble where people are so used these days to going on social media and just dropping in like a smiley face, winky face, all sorts of things. And then maybe even with the same device, they're then sending a message, which could be an email or a text, to someone they work with. And I've come across a situation where that's gone badly wrong, where it's felt way too sort of personal,
informal, casual, not
worked. But on the other end of the scale, you've got people who sometimes are writing an email that seems so formal that people receiving it feel like it's a legal
document.
Dear sir, So how do you help people navigate that, with sort of any rules around what to do or not to do in sort of email or written communication?
Absolutely. And I train a lot on how to write. I'm basically email etiquette.
Right.
And here's the thing, just, you know, my generation has been respectful of the generation above and how they like to communicate.
Yeah.
And they were respectful of their generation above. And I don't think that changes. I'm not suddenly going to be accepting of someone sending me a smiley, winky face and fingers and whatever on an email, because I wasn't able to do that to my generation. So I think this is one thing where the newcomers have to learn how to send business emails. Yeah. And it's business emails.
Yeah.
And for that, it's very much, I use the DISC model as well. Right. So if I'm writing an email and I know that my boss is a D, no more than 3 bullet points. But hi, here's the update you requested, 3 bullet points from die. But if my boss is a C, I'll go, hi, da 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 da. Here's all the bullet points you need, but there's also an attachment, a link to the policy document. So I'm writing emails in the way that I know these people want to receive. Yeah. If I'm writing to an I or an S, and for those who don't know DISC, it's the dominant influences, supportive and conscientious. It's a few words get changed around if you go to different countries.
Yeah.
But if I'm writing to an I, they're happy with paragraphs. And hey, how was your weekend? Are you watching Love Island? Yeah. Did you see Strictly Come Dancing? Da, 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 da. Now, what's happening? Yeah. Or is that D's won't read that? So I think it's less of a generational thing. It's, well, this generation need to learn just how to write a business email. And it's frankly a skill. It's just how to write a business email.
Yeah.
You can do what you like. These guys aren't even on email anymore.
Right. Yeah,
well, they've probably got an email account, but that's not how they communicate.
Yeah.
So it's teaching them this is a business skill, much like meeting behaviors. You know, you're going to be going into organizations, or they're going to be going into organizations where there's 5 generations now in the office. So I don't think anyone who's 65 is suddenly going, great, let's just have meetings how a 19-year-old wants them.
Yeah.
There is just some respect that needs to be happening, unless you go into a startup or somewhere where the boss is 23, different story. But if you're going into corporate, there are things you just need to learn how to behave in corporate so you don't get fired.
Yeah,
or you get onto the grad program if you're an intern, or you get hired after your grad program.
Yeah.
And I think that's the mindset that a manager can have with a grad is, right, I not only want to turn you into a rock star, I want to get you a job at the end of your grad program that you want. So let's work towards that. And here's all the unwritten rules that you need to learn about, business etiquette, and really help them with that.
Yeah.
And give them feedback. I mean, I used to get emails from my intern, and in fact, a lot of my team, and I would just say, well, first of all, you're sitting there, I'm here, you can come and talk to me. Because there's quite a fear, the face-to-face is not natural for them.
Yeah.
So inviting them to give them more opportunity for face-to-face.
I was asked actually once, did I think that the kind of coaching work that my team does, which is generally about face-to-face communication, would there be less need for that in future because people are more on screens? And I said, people are going to need more help than ever before.
Exactly.
Because younger generations do much more communication like this than they do like this.
Yeah, it's true.
And it's such a critical skill. Yeah. In fact, we were talking on a previous podcast about webinars and how more frequent they are becoming.
Yeah.
And so people are less skilled at just being in a room with someone and knowing how to do that.
Absolutely.
So let's look at that then from the perspective too. And I think this is always a challenging one, is the managing upwards.
Mm.
So let's say that someone's listening to this who's thinking, yeah, this really sounds like the advice I need.
Yeah.
I really wish I could give feedback to someone who is more senior than me or in some way. What can they be doing? How can they do that in a way that's going to work?
I think there's two parts. There's one, managing upwards, and then there's giving feedback. And I think if you just look at managing upwards, I really just get into the mindset where we all know how to manage upwards. We just haven't applied it in the business context.
Right.
So at my age, when I go home and stay with my mum in Australia, who's 81, if I'm staying in her house, and I'm 50, if I'm staying in her house and I go out for the evening with my friends, I'm getting a text going, what time will you be home? I'm like, oh my God, I'm 50. Does it matter? It does. So what I do is I say, hi mum, I'm going out with Jane tonight. I'm going to be gone. I might stay at Jane's. I'll text you if I am. Otherwise, I'll be home at 2 a.m. She goes, great. That's managing upwards. We all do it with our parents. We know how to do that.
Yeah.
Whether it's a lie or not, doesn't matter. But all managing upwards is setting expectations for your boss and letting them know you've done stuff. So some of these practical things, what I've noticed is, firstly, a lot of grads, interns don't bring anything to write on.
Yeah.
So there's a sense, if you're my manager and you've given me a whole lot of things and I go, okay, yep, There's no sense. It's like, you know, when you order something from a waiter and they go, yeah, I'll take your order. You want eggs and bacon, bacon and eggs and bacon with a sausage and a tomato. And you go, they're not going to get that. It's like that. So even if you've got a photographic memory, write stuff down, because what I'm doing is managing upwards, going, great, yep. Anything else, Richard? Yep, great, great, great. Mm. You then relax knowing I've got it. You can switch off. If I haven't written anything down, you're going to be thinking, and then you're going to have a question. Did you do that and that and that? And that's not the sort of relationship you want, because you're going parent-child.
Is there a bit of a proactive managing of like expectations and what behaviours will you want from me in that sort of way? Or
Very much so, very much about, and for managers, it's help these guys out in the very early days, because what you don't want to do is get 6 months down the road and then say, by the way, I've noticed that you don't take notes in meetings and I feel very anxious when you don't take notes in meetings. Oh, great. Well, we're 6 months in now and I haven't been taking notes. Would have been helpful at the beginning. Yeah. So nip all this, because they don't know. They're not trying to be difficult. They're not trying to be stupid. Yeah. They just, it is not natural to write things down.
Yeah.
It's maybe to type stuff up, but I have still been to meetings with these young guys who don't take anything down.
Yeah.
So it's very much just thinking about, as a manager, what do I need for you to be successful in my team? Here's how I behave. Here's how I work. Mm. When I say this, that's what this means.
Yeah.
And the same goes for the feedback, really. As a manager, you have to be open to upward feedback from these guys.
Yeah.
So as a manager, first of all, you need to offer the opportunity to them to say, and just do it really informally over a coffee. Or my best advice, don't even have face-to-face, because if they've got something to tell you, go for a walk. Then they don't have to look at you. You don't have to look at them. It feels like it's not a big deal.
Mm.
So you can go for a walk. Let's go get a coffee outside.
Yeah.
So you've got somewhere to go and you've had a chat. So how are things getting on? How are things getting on is a terrible question, because they go, yeah, fine, thanks. Getting them to really open up. And I teach a model called SBI, which is explain the situation, what the behaviours were and the impact that it had. So it can be, yesterday in that meeting, you were amazing. If I just said that, that's not helpful. Thanks. It was a five-hour meeting. I was on Instagram for 4.5 of it. Which bit was I amazing? But if I said, you know, Richard, yesterday in that meeting situation, you were fantastic. When you stood up and presented, you just had real gravitas. You made eye contact with everyone in the room. You had really good gestures. And the impact, everyone's talking about what a rock star you were.
Yeah.
You're like, great, I can repeat that.
Yeah.
But give that model to the intern as well. Let them do it to you, to say, you know, if you're my boss, actually, Richard, in that meeting yesterday, when you put me on the spot and I didn't have the answer, I felt really silly and I'm less likely to go to these meetings again if that happens.
Right.
But give them the framework. So it's not about too much emotion. It's quite a factual situation, behavior, impact.
Yeah.
But you've got to teach them the model and let them know it's okay to give feedback, but mean it. Because if you ask people for feedback and they give it to you, you got to be ready for what's coming.
and take action on it. Otherwise, you're not going to get more of that feedback too. I really like the idea of this, of the go for a walk and a coffee.
Yeah.
Because it's less like sort of forwards. Both of you it just feels like you can gently mention something and that someone will take
it on board. And use the walk for the chat. Don't wait till you've got the coffee.
Right.
Because that often happens, going, gosh, we'll go get a coffee and how was your weekend? Da, 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 da. And then we've got a coffee each, which is 6 minutes. I've now got 6 minutes to make eye contact with you. You want to look at me for 6 minutes.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. So go have all that conversation. And this is in, you know, this positive stuff as well. Because what I've found in certain cultures, so certainly in Australia and the UK, we're very bad at giving positive feedback. We just go, good job yesterday.
Yeah.
Whereas that's where that model's really useful, to say situation, behavior, impact, because they've got to know the impact. And that's where yesterday you're sitting at your desk twirling your hair.
Yeah.
What do you think people are thinking? But the impact is
really specific on
you
that
look
too.
Like you're into, you look like the intern. Up to you if that's what, and they're going, oh shit. Yeah. Sorry.
I also wonder, this is maybe going a bit broader on your experience, something that's come to mind is there a sense these days, with everything being sort of instantly available online, and I'll give you an example from a friend of mine who is sort of looking for the right lady in his life for a long time. He was on all the social sort of dating sites, which didn't exist in the time in which I met my wife.
Yeah.
And how did it go on that day? It's like, yeah, she was fantastic. She just had a couple more freckles than I was expecting. And then he says, but the thing is, you can go back onto your phone and then you just swipe left or swipe right, and then you can try again.
Delete.
And
oh
try
God.
And find perfection. And I just sort of wonder if that has fed into society a little bit, where maybe people get an intern or somebody new joining their team, and if they're not instantly the way that they should be, they go, I'm just going to find somebody else because I can instantly just go and
look for
someone
else. Oh, I did it. 2 months in, I went to HR going, can I give her back? Because that's where I'm like, I've got a wrong one here. There must be some goodies. But actually, she turned out to be, and really when she left, she was one of the top 3 out of 100 interns by country mile,
right?
Because she'd had someone invest in her. So,
let's
it's very much the case.
Like how that journey can happen, because I'm sure there's many people listening to this thinking, okay, I've got too many
freckles.
I must get rid of those freckles. But there may be people listening thinking, I really want to take who I believe is a lovely person to work with who isn't achieving very much and make them one of the rock stars of the company. So there's going to be that back and forth feedback happening.
Yeah.
But I also wonder, from your perspective of having been head of learning and training for so many companies, what is it that some companies do well and others do badly in terms of really assessing what are the needs that we have here around what people say early on in their career, even later on, what are they doing well at figuring out, we know that you need this, and where are the gaps where they're just not realizing this is where we should be investing?
I think the first thing is neglecting talent who are going to be there for a short period of time. So firstly, just neglecting them altogether, putting them on your corporate induction for a day, going, well, they're just here for the summer.
Yeah.
The amount of time HR will spend cleaning up the mess of an intern here for the summer who just went on a corporate induction and they understand the brand and the values and they know who the CEO is.
Mm.
You have to invest in those guys, even if they're there for a week. You've got to train them in behaviors and give them the expectations of this company.
Mm.
That's where I come in and that's what I do.
Yeah.
But I think the other thing, like you alluded to earlier, we wait far too long to give people skills in how to present.
Yeah.
And that's a big thing that I think, I got that very early on, I think because I was a teacher as well. So that's my background. So I learned to stand up with a group of kids with a whistle.
Yeah.
Tell you what, it's tough when they took the whistle away. Yeah, no, I was just a grade 2 teacher. I just needed control. No, I definitely was a PE teacher. But so I had some grounding in, how to lead teams and how to stand up and have gravitas, because you have to with 6-year-olds.
Yeah.
So I sort of got that by accident and became a trainer.
Mm.
But I see, you are going to ask your interns to stand up and present something they've learned or something they've done.
Yeah.
And you're setting them up for embarrassment, failure, fear, loathing, bad dreams for the rest of their lives if you don't help them do that.
Well, they tend to come to me 25 years later
and you have
saying,
to undo the damage.
Well,
they all do. Yeah, it's absolutely true. But I think the other thing is around body language and giving them some training. And most people don't know this stuff exists. Like, you got the book when you were 16.
Yeah.
I got it when I was about 30 going, how have I not known this?
Yeah.
Is just, how to build just NLP. Just give them a book if you don't give them on a training course, but help them understand how they're going to build rapport really, really quickly at senior leadership level and junior, because they want to.
Yeah.
And I think the other thing for me is just things like how to have a good handshake.
Right.
The number of handshakes that I get from junior people straight out of uni.
Yeah.
I was actually at a university today talking to them about the sort of content that I would deliver to them. And I said, I don't know what parents are doing, because I sort of thought I don't think my parents taught me how to handshake either. Who knows what my handshake was like when I was 20.
Yeah.
So things like how to make proper eye contact.
Yeah.
And for that, I give them this tip, and managers as well, is if you look at someone's eyes when you meet them and you look at the color of their eyes, you look at them very differently. How I'm looking at you now feels very different. It's like, a little bit too intimate because we know each other.
Yeah.
But helping them with skills like that, helping them with an elevator pitch, because a number of times I've come across interns and grads and I go, oh, hi, I'm Di, I head up learning or whatever. What are you doing? Oh, I'm an intern.
Right.
Okay, whose team are you in? Oh, I'm in John Smith's team. What are you doing at uni? Studying business. What uni?
Right.
So helping them, and one of the things I do really early on in their first day is handshake, eye contact, give them get their own elevator pitch that says, hi, I'm Jane. I'm an intern for the next 12 months. I'm working in John Smith's team marketing. Yeah. I'm studying at Birmingham University. I finished business management in a year and I would love a job in the ACD team.
Yeah, which straight away, if you put it like that, whoever they meet is going to think, I wish that person was on
my
team.
Man, that looks good. And they feel great. Confident yeah. and credible. Yeah. And then the second thing is teaching them what to do with their body while they're doing that. Mm. Not going, yeah. hi, I'm Jane. yeah. You know, I'm really petrified.
Yeah. yeah.
So giving them how to have gravitas in a room.
Yeah.
So, and you guys give that to them in folds, but too late.
Yeah. So that,
get them on his course earlier.
So the gravitas and the words matching, that's a key one. The one I just wanted to come back to for a moment, because it's a question that comes up so much for me is, you know, because of running a company called Body Talk, people talk to us about things like eye contact a lot. And I love the way that you put that tip, which I've not heard described that way before, of looking to see the person's eye color so you see them more clearly, is that I think a lot of what I've noticed in companies, for people of all generations, is that there's a lot of armor happening where you get a bunch of people around a table where they're not really connected with anybody in that room. And they leave, they go home, and they effectively take their armor off and think, oh, do I have to put that armor on again and go back in tomorrow?
Back to the game tomorrow.
And so, even as you said it, like there's that stronger connection when you properly look into somebody's eyes, is that sense of, you know, I can really see you and you can really see me and we're going to connect as humans
here. Yeah, you do,
which I think can help get away from that sort of seniority, you will do this, yes, I will master sort of position or fear around feedback, is to really just go, we're two humans, let's do that piece of connection. Have you noticed that over the years of, you know, that sort of lack of ability to have really strong, deep, true connection between people?
And I think, having worked in companies, you know, very corporate organizations with very strict hierarchies, I think people at the top, in some of them, and I've certainly worked in, you know, very big global organizations where that's not the case, but I have certainly worked in places where higher people don't want anything to do with the lower people.
Yeah.
And how I've overcome that, and what I would say to both interns and to managers of interns and grads and apprentices or just, you know, young talent, is help them connect. So the first thing I'll train, well, first thing in the first day, what I will train these grads, interns, is if you're going into a meeting and there's eight people around there, think of it as a dinner party. What would you do at a dinner party?
Yeah.
They go, what's a dinner party? When your mum and dad have people around, but you would introduce yourself. Yeah. You'd go, hi, I'm Di, I'm the intern, elevator pitch, quick little snappy, I'm the intern in John's team. Hi, diet, and asking them, and they'll go, she's impressive. Whereas they don't do that. They come in, they sit in the meeting like that.
Yeah.
And the other thing, though, is then for the managers, if your intern's not doing that or hasn't quite got the oomph to do that, do that for them. Mm. Go around and say, or just say, guys, before we start the meeting, just want everyone to meet Jane. She's new today. She's my intern. She's here for the next 12 months.
Yeah.
She's going to be focusing on this, 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 and this. Yeah. Okay, let's go.
Yeah, that can be,
but you've got to help
nice
them.
And empowering and uplifting for them.
Yeah.
I also think that in what you said there, there's almost like a hidden gem of a lesson for people who are senior in a business, where I've noticed this a lot, where if I'm working with leaders, there is a fear of expressing themselves, which, and I tend to see this.
Do you think it's a fear of being wrong?
Fear of being wrong because of being picked on for that, but also fear of showing emotion. I tend to see this more in men than women, I think, is that sort of alpha male sense of, if I show emotion, I'm therefore vulnerable, I can therefore be attacked, I'm therefore not the alpha. And the lesson that I'm often sharing is to say, but if you have the strength and the courage to put the armor down and be vulnerable, that is greater power in itself and it's greater connection. And so I think that there's a nice lesson there for anybody who is listening to what you just said, thinking, I wouldn't want the intern to come and speak to me. I'm the CEO. What should they be thinking? Yeah. It's much, much more powerful for them to think, actually, if I put the armor down, if I go and sit at the same table at lunch as the interns are, that's seen as a strength, not seen as a failure.
It's the Brené Brown book. Have you read Brené? I mean, you even have to just watch a six-minute video of her talking about vulnerability.
Power and vulnerability.
Amazing.
Yeah.
But I think also I'd say to CEOs, senior directors, people who are doing that, why don't you want a team of rock stars working for you?
Yeah.
And why wouldn't you do everything you can to create the conditions for success? So another book that I rave about, my husband thinks I'm crazy because I'm Australian, it's Clive Woodward's book, Winning. Have you read that?
I've seen him speak live,
Okay, even better.
Last year. Great.
But he has this mindset of his job as the director of rugby at the time was to create the conditions for success for all of his team. Yeah. Haven't got a laptop? I'll go get laptops. Haven't got that? We're in a terrible hotel? I'm going to take charge of it.
Yeah.
And it's all about you can't do your best work if your laptop doesn't work, you're in a chair that's broken, your CEO doesn't talk to you. So I think a mentality for leaders should be, what do I need to do to create the conditions for success for these people?
Yeah.
And then make it happen.
Well, let's talk about that a bit then, because I noticed that you mentioned that at Apple there was these award-winning training rooms that you were helping to create, so the conditions for success in training.
Yeah.
Now, I know on the harsh opposite side of things
how... When you're shoved into a room on the eighth floor in Hammersmith.
Yeah, I've had it where, I mean, you know, in my 19 years of this, there was one, I won't mention the company, where it was genuinely the sort of the stock room, the store cupboard.
I did that a few weeks ago,
right, and you think,
no light,
really? Yeah, there's no light, there's
chairs,
even one
and tables
once where there was
shoved.
No heating, and it was white walls, and it generally felt like a walk-in freezer. And I thought, you expect me to change behaviors successfully here? Really?
Create the conditions for success, please.
Creating the conditions for success, what can people do who are higher up in a company to make sure that happens day to day? What can they be thinking about?
When it comes to environment, I'm just a huge, huge fan of really making sure the environment is somewhere where people want to come every day.
Yeah.
And especially for training, I think I learned a lot at Apple about, you know, they had beautiful offices and their training facilities were fantastic. But that aside, everything worked. If you went in to have a video conference, there's already anxiety around a video conference and a spider thing and connecting a presentation to...
Yeah.
You know, and I've been in that situation. So I was at a company the other day that Macs just don't work in their offices.
Yeah.
It's like, okay.
Yeah.
So I'm now, you know, I'm walking around with one leg because you've tied it to me. So I think creating the condition of success is looking at do you need this intern young person? In fact, what do you need this 35-year-old director to do in your team? And what's getting in the way of them doing that really, really well? And what's slowing them down?
Yeah.
From a training perspective, I think it's so important to have the right environment. So EE, I think one of my legacy there was creating award-winning training rooms. They were, I think have you seen them there?
It depends on which
your
one.
Team might
have some of them.
But we then scattered them around the country as well above retail stores, and they were just done beautifully, but thoughtfully around, well, people are going to want to sit on sofas when they're learning, and they don't want to sit in a chair like this for a whole day because you hurt your back. So build some sofas. But also have a look at, you know, sometimes we have, I build a whole series of things called power hours in the last company I was at. And what better place to run a power hour than on the London Eye? Two laps is an hour. Give people some champagne, 1 hour of training, and that lands. And it was, so thinking about how can I best make that land? And it's just as simple as, let me take her for a Starbucks coffee to have a chat rather than let's go and get a meeting room, which sometimes signals not great things are coming.
Yeah, and actually, tapping into something you were saying there about like the tech not working, which remember, you know, for so many clients, it's stressful. I find it stressful when I'm going to events where I know there's a lot of tech going on. And it was a lovely situation I had recently. I did a session in Canada where quite often when I run this session, I did it recently for, what was it? I was with Expedia, I was in Las Vegas, about 600 people, big stage, big sound system.
I booked you for that, didn't I? It was a before me,
And so it was great. And then I ran it in somebody's living room just recently, and it was just me and a notebook and a little speaker.
Yeah.
And I thought, actually, you know, what I used to do the first 8 years that we ran the company, we didn't have a laptop. I didn't own a computer.
Yeah.
It was before the age where, you know, more people did. And it was such a relief for so many people. I'd go in, turn off the projector, get rid of the projection screen, say, let's learn how to communicate without technology again, shall we?
Yeah.
And so I think it's quite a nice lesson from what you're saying there to create an environment that is nice where people can just connect with each other and not need the technology to be part of that communication where it's just one.
And for development as well, because I've been, you know, I've been to conferences where people are talking about digital learning and building platforms, and I've built 5 apps now. So you've got to build digital platforms, you've got to build digital content because you've got a global team. Yeah. You've got one person in Tasmania, 2 in Koh Samui. Mm. You're not flying them in, you're not flying trainers out. So you do need that.
Yeah.
But ultimately, you have to have that balance of the face-to-face. And I will always say to people, if you really honestly believe that learning can occur 100% online, would you have your hair cut by someone who learned to cut hair online? Funnily enough, they go, well, no, not that, but well, come on. You know, there's part things you can learn, but there's knowledge, skills, behavior, and knowledge, you can do all that online. Skills, you have to be able to, and especially the sort of stuff that we do, I have to see how you're communicating now in order to fix it. And I can't do that remotely. And So I think that's a huge thing as well, as, you know, create the conditions for success, which definitely mean you have to have a digital platform, but also you have to know when you spend the time, invest the money for people to do some face-to-face stuff. That's why people have team builds. You know, they know that.
Yeah.
They know, we should go and have a team build off-site, face-to-face.
Yeah. I think sometimes it gets lost as well with team builds, where people think, great, let's get together and
once
do paintballing.
Yeah.
And then we're a better team. But they need to understand actually the communication that comes into that better team.
Yeah.
Also thinking about the conditions of success, I know that people listening to this will want me to ask you this question.
Yeah.
We spoke about it briefly before we started, which is when people hear that you've worked with, you know, with retail training for Apple, and not just people in the Apple stores, but people in, say, a Vodafone store who are then talking about the iPhone. And because it was so successful, people must ask you this all the time, which is, how can we have that level of success in our retail? Like, what do we do? Yeah. How does that happen?
The first question is, why did you leave Apple? That's the first question. Like, okay. Things aren't always as they seem on the inside as the outside. But, oh, no, I loved Apple. I learned a load. Some of them, I work with the best people.
Yeah.
Just amazing, amazing people, and learned loads. It was a fantastic place to work.
Yeah.
But to answer your question about how do we have that, I think there's a couple of fundamental differences. I think Apple spent more money on education than advertising. Now, quote, that's sort of also a model because they'd get carriers and network operators to pay for a lot of their advertising anyway.
Right.
But they got education. They would put people through 4 weeks minimum of training before you were even allowed to go in a store.
Wow.
And even then, you weren't ready. But before that, I think, and I've worked in places where you don't even get, I went to sign up to a new mobile phone work network operator the other day.
Right.
I won't mention their names. and the guy said, oh, you know, what network are you on? And I said, oh, I'm on this network because I used to work for them and da-da-da. Mm. And he said, oh, right, what did you do there? I said, oh, I used to head up training. He goes, oh, hate training. I gave it a miss. And I'm thinking, I'm sitting here, and you're communicating, I can tell you gave it a miss. Because you're a nightmare.
Yeah.
But I said, what did the training look like? Oh, we just had to go in somewhere in London for a couple of days. And I said, so you just came to the store and you've just started selling phones. Yeah. I'm thinking, oh my God, that's why I'm having a terrible experience with you.
Yeah.
You don't know it.
Yeah.
So Apple had the money, but it wasn't about the money. It was about the mentality that if I don't train these people properly, the customer experience is going to be a nightmare.
Yeah.
Secondary to that, which I think is probably an obvious thing, is that if there's a job opening for an Apple store and one for Carphone Warehouse, these people are probably not the same kettle of fish.
Yeah.
And I know, you know, working at Apple, a lot of people who worked in the Apple store were photographers or filmmakers or people who used Apple equipment in their day-to-day life and were finishing up at uni or at uni but obsessed by Apple. It was a very good way of making money.
Yeah.
But they worked in retail because it was Apple and they probably wouldn't work in a network operator store at Vodafone or Carphone or wherever or The Gap. They are working in retail because it's Apple and they are obsessed by the brand, the equipment, and they're super knowledgeable. It's interesting that they don't do as much product training as you would think because there's an expectation that you need to know your stuff. Yeah, new product launches, absolutely.
Yeah.
So I think it's a combination of their hiring strategy, and also you can imagine you advertise for a new store opening at Apple or even one job at Apple.
Number of applications they get.
It's like a queue around the block, like a new phone launch.
How did you do it then if it wasn't somebody who works for Apple but someone who's worked working, say, at another network provider, and they're being trained up to try and give that same Apple sort of special Apple feeling. How do you give that Apple feeling?
What we actually did was we handpicked people from store who looked like the sort of people. Right. Well, we would ask the Vodafones of the world to handpick the people that would be Apple ambassadors. Mm. And so we made it something very special. Mm. And the training they got, they came to Apple for the training. So there was that, oh my God, I'm at Apple. Mm. Wow, I'm at Apple. And of course, it's all done beautifully.
Yeah.
And it's all done carefully. And that's what I've learned from telco is everything. And in fact, retail, everything's very, very quick. Oh, that they've done that. We better change that. Change. Mm. Whereas Apple are very, very clear about how they launch something. So when they came for training, it was very much, wow, this is amazing. Yeah. And it was followed up. They were given phones, which was, you know, and given iPhones. It's not rare to get a phone if you work in a mobile phone shop, but it's rare to be given an iPhone. And then the next year it's upgraded. You're still the ambassador in store.
Yeah.
So, and also the training was fantastic. You know, it was engaging. It was, you know, and so it was selling more the Apple magic to them first, so they could then pass it on to the customer. And of course, you then teach them the practicalities of how to do a good demo and how to actually sell the features and benefits of an iPhone.
Yeah. So, I'm fascinated by what you said about spending more money on education than on advertising. Because
that was when I was there anyway.
Right.
Don't know what they're doing now.
Well, I think
I'm sure it's the same. Yeah.
Well,
it wouldn't surprise me. Yeah.
Because, I mean, if you look at it from other companies' point of views, I'm sure it's the case that when they say, okay, we need to have some cutbacks, well, we still need people to know who we are, advertise, let's not do so much in
training. Training's always cut, yep.
But it's fool's gold to go in that direction.
Totally.
You've got to have brilliant communicators, because if you do, the advertising isn't as required. So
it's the same with grad programs. Why have a grad program and then not teach them how to be brilliant? Don't get it. It's a very expensive thing to do.
Yeah.
And interns, and I think, you know, they're becoming more prevalent now, and especially with apprentice schemes. Apprentices are coming in and going on grad-like programs where they're being paid to go to university or to college to get a degree under the umbrella of a company. They're investing very heavily down that end because there's government funding, so it's easy. But there's a bit of neglect, I think, for the interns, grads, or the new starters out of school even who've missed all of that.
I know that there's a couple of clients that I work with who seem to really get it, that if they can get brilliant talent at the beginning, the potential for the company in the years to come is extraordinary.
It's true.
So I can see them doing well into the future. So maybe if we sort of draw this to a close on two people who might be listening to this. So say let's start with one person who is thinking, really enjoyed this, lots of inspiration here. I'm going into work tomorrow. I have some relatively young people on my team. What are the top sort of two or three things I should just keep in mind that I'm going to do this week that is going to start to move us in the right direction?
I think the very first thing is your mindset, because if you're going to go in with a mindset, and I think I blame Simon Sinek for the mindset, because whilst I think he's brilliant, he does talk about everything that's wrong with his Gen X and we've all seen that video, and he's right. Oh, they get a ribbon for turning up. Da, da, da. That's not their fault. They've grown up in this generation. They've all been grown up with a phone. That's not their fault. So I think the first thing is your mindset. If you're going in with a mindset of, these kids have got everything, they were born lucky in my day. Nothing else you'll do will matter, because they will see that straight away and your body language will give it away as well. I think if you can, so go in with a mentality of, these are going to be rock stars, and it's my job to train them to be rock stars, or find the support within or without to help them become rock stars. I think the second thing is teach them to how to, and I mean, I can obviously come and do this, but they can themselves, teach them how to have a proper handshake, make eye contact, introduce themselves when they're in meetings, and have an elevator pitch. You can do that in a team meeting. You can do it in a one-to-one. Rehearse it with them. Rehearse it with them. Be vulnerable so you can share what yours is and the mistakes you've made.
Yeah.
I think the other thing is never to use the term "in my day" or, you know, you need to have 10 years. I remember somebody I worked with once who, in a very big senior leadership team meeting, said, how do we make them stay for 10 years? Why would you want to?
Right.
So understand that you might have these kids, and they are kids. You might have them for 6 months, 9 months, a year, 2 years.
Mm.
get as much as you can into them so that they leave you really well equipped for the world. And guess what? They might come back in a few years' time.
Yeah.
But if you don't invest in them, they're not going to come back.
Yeah.
And I think the third thing for me is help them to present, because they're going to need those skills, and those skills just come in handy all over the place. Body language. And if you don't know anything about it, ring Richard or me, but read up on it. It is not rocket science, but help them. How can I build rapport when I get into an elevator with a senior manager, or if I'm in a networking event?
Yeah.
Oh, there, speak about the dress code made by the devil. Yeah. Networking events for young people, awful. hate them.
Yeah.
So help them create the conditions for success. I think they're big things.
I love what you said about the rehearsal piece, which I wanted to pick up on for anybody listening going, oh no, I want to be authentic. I want to be the real me.
Oh yeah, really.
I hear this all the time.
Yeah. Sure, the authentic leader. Yeah, of course.
Yeah, and someone saying, well, this is just how I am, and therefore I'm not changing, I'm not rehearsing, I'm not learning new behaviours.
Yeah. Behaviours, yeah.
Right, yeah, so let's try just changing those and putting these in. And to think about what you said with cutting hair, you might know how to use a pair of scissors, but let's just get more effective about that. You wouldn't just go, okay, let's just try this haircut out. Let's practice it until you feel really confident and then go in. And then maybe as a last thought on top tips for the younger people who may be listening to this thinking, I really feel like I'm struggling right now. Mm. So I'm going to work on that sort of elevator pitch. How can I go and have an effective conversation with my manager that isn't going to make them feel like they're doing the wrong thing?
You just watched a podcast or listened to a podcast.
Could you watch this with me? But how do they start to have that conversation where maybe they're getting more of the support they need?
I think going in with their mindset in a positive place as well, that their managers may never have managed someone so young in a different generation, and they need help. And they might not be able to ask for help. So offering some up might be really useful. But I think the best thing that people have asked me in the past that I think, oh, that's a clever question, has been, first of all, how do you best like to work? What can I do to really be more effective with you? So I know I communicate with you via email, on phone, text, whatever. Mm. So I used to have this thing geared up with my whole team. Yeah. And I learned this from an American girl, Melissa, who taught me this. And she had a whole lot of young people join her once. And she said to them, you need to ask 20 questions a day. And I think that's because they're used to being high achievers. They're in university, they've come out on the grad program, and they go, and I'll go, do you think they're all right? Don't know. But asking them to ask 20 questions a day, that's something for the managers, actually.
Yeah.
But what I had then, what she taught me then was, because she then got bombarded with questions, was separate your questions into a 911 and a 111 or a 101. Right. For UK, it's... What do you call
999? 999 and 101, I think.
So about every country will have an emergency services, my house is on fire.
Yeah.
And they'll have there's a cat up. There's always a cat up the tree. Cats can always get down from a tree, but you get the gist.
Yeah.
And then if you're an intern and you've got burning questions, write down your 9. If you get something that's a 999, 911, whatever country you're in, I would give permission for my team to say, if you've got a 911 and you cannot go on with your work, please interrupt me. Here's the best way to interrupt me by text if I'm in a meeting. Don't call me, because if I'm in a meeting, I'll go, a text, I can see that. Mm. Or if you're sitting there, come and talk to me.
Yeah.
Don't email me, because I've got 4,000 emails a day. So then on your other ones, your 101s or your 111s, whatever the other non-emergency, save them up for the end of the day. Grab your manager and just say, I've got a few questions. You've got 10 minutes.
Mm.
Oh, your manager will be so pleased that you've consolidated those questions. You go, right, I've just got a few things. I don't understand that acronym. And you will look so invested in your job. You'll look so on it.
Yeah.
And you've also got the nous to keep a list of questions, and don't keep them on different pages or type them up. It doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
But I think the 999, 911 was a saviour for me. I think the other thing is just, somebody asked me once, was what's keeping you awake at night right now? Business-wise. So I'm like, oh, what is worrying? Well, this is worrying me. Is there anything I can do to alleviate some of that? Can I help? So asking that question.
Yeah.
And I think the final thing then, because a lot of managers don't know what work to give you, and they'll give you tasks and you might finish those tasks in 2 hours or 4 days, and they won't know, because they'll be like, well, can you do that, 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 that? Yeah. Now, it would take Jenny 20 minutes, but it might take you 3 days, and I don't really care. It doesn't matter.
If you say, how are you getting on? They go, fine.
So I think if you're given a whole lot of tasks, first of all, managers don't know how long it will take. Second of all, they don't always tell you the prioritization. Ask them. Mm. So make sure in that 10 minutes a day or whenever you have one-to-ones, go, right, just so you're clear, here's all the things I'm working on. Mm. I'm going to approach this, 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 and this. Is that the right priority for you? Do you want anything done earlier? Can I have a date that you want this done by?
Yeah.
Because managers are terrible at delegating with timelines. We're just not used to it.
Yeah.
We're not used to it. We are really used to it. We're just really bad at it. So asking, so that's start to managing upwards, and people are like, oh God, oh, she's on top of it. So,
I love that. And I actually love the fact that, you know, to sort of widen this a little bit for anybody who's listening thinking, well, I don't really manage interns, I'm not an intern myself. I think that a theme that's gone through everything that you've been sharing is that it's so critical with communication. If you go from one company to another or one team to another, just to check in with the people around you, not to assume that, well, this is how I've always communicated and that was fine before. Yeah. Check in with, is this the communication that's going to work here for you in these situations and keep going back and forth until you get into that complete
and
rhythm?
I agree. And even if you're 60 and you go to a new company, you have to understand the culture of communication. Are we an email culture? Do we CC everybody? Yeah. Do I have to get my boss to write an email to that senior person, or can I just do it?
Yeah.
So find out the ground rules and have that really open conversation with your boss.
Yeah.
But I think, and then the very final thing, if you're a young person going to a one-to-one is your meeting. It's not your boss's meeting. Your boss has 8-10 of those a week. Mm. They're a bit of a chore sometimes. Mm. And the worst thing you can do is come up with a blank sheet of paper going, what can I do?
Right, yeah.
If you haven't got objectives, write some and say, is this the sort of thing I should be doing? Yeah. You've asked me to do this, this, this.
Absolutely.
What else can I do that could extend from that? Oh, so I've and it might be as simple as I've cleaned that cupboard, but I've noticed that there's that needs doing and that needs doing and that needs doing. Are you okay if I pick that up? Oh my God, I would love to.
And I have to say that I love that on my team when someone says, can I have a meeting with you? And these are the things I'd like to discuss. I
love it.
Thank goodness, you know what we're discussing.
God.
I can come in and do that with you.
Because I've got the answers.
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay, so
that's what I'd end on.
I'd love to keep going. This is fabulous. I think there's some brilliant practical takeaways. I think anybody listening to this can take stuff away and begin to use it. So if you are fascinated by what we've been talking about and you want to keep learning more and spend more time with Di as well, then you can go to likeliterally.co.uk. And find Di Macdonald. I think she's exceptional in the work that she does, and I've worked with her many times. And so do check out likeliterally.co.uk. And also,
we didn't talk about why I've called it Like Literally.
Oh yeah, let's
that's
finish
the
on that.
The communication thing that kills me is these, and I blame Hannah Montana and now Kim Kardashian.
Yeah.
Because all of this generation, and I with the guise of how not to look like the grad or the intern in the room or the Gen Z, is the word like and like literally, and I like literally died. So that's my final thing. I have I do have some top tips, but you're going to have to come to me if you've got someone like saying that like this, like in every like sentence.
Yeah.
You need to call me. I can fix it.
So there you go. Right. Likeliterally.co.uk. So I hope you've enjoyed that. Do make sure that you put some of this stuff into action. Get in touch with me. Let me know what you enjoyed about this and what other people you'd like to see being on these podcasts, interviewed in future. Let me know what's most valuable for you. So I hope you've enjoyed that, and I'll see you on the next podcast.